So contrary to popular belief, the current thing that we use as money is fiat money, not backed by the gold standard, and is less than 100 years old. So let's see if there is any scope for improvement in the current thing that we use as money, you know, fiat money. So the first thing that I want to talk about is portability. Now, until recently, money was extremely physical in nature. If I had to make a transaction, I would physically give you money. And because money itself would move from me to you, we would not need a third party to confirm this transaction. But in the last few decades, we increasingly transfer money over electronic networks. Now, with electronic money, there is a problem. Because the money does not physically move from me to you, we both need to trust a third-party gatekeeper, like a bank or a credit card company or a clearing house, which we both trust, who oversees and authorizes that, yes, this transaction happened, and confirms the transaction by making a note in their ledger, just in case one of us disputes the transaction. Now, what has happened is, because most of money is being transferred over these electronic networks over the last few decades, these electronic network companies have become extremely powerful. They have the right to not allow certain people of the society from accessing their network. For example, if you are poor, a bank will not open your bank account. If you do not have a good credit card rating, a credit card company will not give you a credit card. So they're extremely powerful. They can, you know, actually disallow you from using the network. And in fact, in an extreme case, they can in fact disallow a transaction on their network. So just think about it. For the first time in the history of money, even if it's your money, the only way you can use electronic money is as permissible by these electronic networks. That was never the case with physical money, all right? So there is a scope that money, of course, should be electronic so that you can move it over an electronic network instantly, but you should also have the right to use it the way you want it without giving your privacy and your details for every purchase that you made, which in many cases gets misused. The second thing that I want to talk about is that we're increasingly global citizens, especially because we are using a global information and data network like the internet. But our currencies are extremely national in nature, which makes it very easy for us to transact people from within the same country, but makes it extremely difficult to transact with people outside the country. And even when you can do that, I mean, if you're among the lucky few who has an international credit card or an overseas bank account, even when you do that, you have to pay a tax, a kind of a fee to these money exchangers. Now, this can vary anywhere between 0.5% if you're a large corporate or you want to do a large transaction, to anywhere more than 15% if you're a simple worker in Dubai who wants to send money back home to your family every month. So obviously, there is a scope for improvement, especially considering the fact that as a global economy, we exchanged more than $6 trillion a day, every day. Last year, a figure which is growing by more than 20%. So there's a scope for having a global currency for increasingly global citizens. The third thing that I want to touch upon is that the money that we currently use, fiat money, is susceptible to hyperinflation. Now, what is that? Fiat money for the first time is basically unlimited in supply and free to create. The only way its supply is created, it's made rare, is artificially by the central bank and the government of the nation, by their monetary policy. But once in a while, sometimes for good reasons and sometimes for bad reasons, the government needs to create a lot of money, maybe to fund a war or to kickstart an economy from depression, and sometimes when the elections are coming, for populist measures. Now, when that happens, for no fault of ours, our existing money loses value, and that's called inflation. And when it happens in a dramatic way over a very short period of time, it's called hyperinflation. With fiat money, which is only 100 years old, there have already been more than 55 cases of hyperinflation in the last 100 years. Some of the more interesting ones have been in 2008, the Zimbabwe dollar was losing half its value every 25 hours. In fact, at one point of time, the Zimbabwe dollar, you can just use it as toilet paper. 100 billion of them could buy you 3 eggs. Very recently, that's just in 2014, end of 2014, the Russian ruble, I mean, imagine the size of the Russian economy. The ruble lost 40% of its value in a very short period of time. In fact, on one day, in mid-December, it lost 19% of its value. That's hyperinflation. And we all know about the Asian financial crisis, which in 1997, the national currencies of all nations lost a dramatic amount of its of their value in a very short period of time. So the thing that we use as money, like previous times, should be resistant to hyperinflation so that the purchasing power of the money that we already have is protected.